What the heck do I do with all these four link bars? What do I do with my ladder bars? How do I get this freaking thing to hook? Hey, welcome back to Kevin Wilson SBC. I want to spend a few minutes today talking about four link bar angles and the anti-squat line. Those are the only two things I want to talk about today. I'll do another video soon on spring rates. I'll do another video soon on pinion angle. I'll do another video soon on front end rise. Today is talking about four links, anti-squat line, and I'm going to primarily focus on slicks. So hopefully this makes sense to you. Please like and subscribe to the channel. If you look down in the right-hand corner of the screen, you'll see a please subscribe. Click on it, hit subscribe, turn your alerts on, hit the little bell icon. That way you will know as I post more of these four link and rear suspension videos for launching a drag car. Let's get started. On this board right now, I have a picture, very rudimentary. Imagine with me, please, a picture of the ground, a front tire, and a rear axle. It's a huge freaking axle, isn't it? But just pretend that's the flange of a rear end, and the center there is the axle. I didn't want to draw the rear tire because I want to be able to talk about bottom bar and upper bar angles. So first thing I want to talk about is this line running diagonal is what we call an anti-squat line. Anti-squat line. And this dot right here is called the center of gravity. That's a pretty important piece to know about your vehicle. So I want to spend a few minutes talking about that. Let's talk about how do we get that measurement, because the height of that measurement is pretty important and the location on your car helps a lot as well. So the anti-squat line, you always start it on the road beneath the center of your slick, and you take the anti-squat line, as you draw an imaginary line to the center of your front spindle where it crosses the height of the center of gravity line. I'm going to want to know where in relation to your wheelbase does that center of gravity line fall. In the description of all of my videos, I have a lot of information in the description, and I share links to other tools and other sites that are important for you to look at. And I'm going to share a link in the bottom of the description that's going to tell you how to calculate the height of your center of gravity line. For today, I'm going to use this mark, and one thing you can do is use the center line of your camshaft, the height of your camshaft with the car race ready, ready to make a run. What's the height of your camshaft from the center line to the ground? And that's a good height to start with. In the link, I'm going to share a website that tells you exactly how to find the height of your center of gravity line. It is really cool. And I'm going to explain a lot of this today, but the website will do much more justice. Also in the description, I'm going to share the instant center calculation website. I have that in almost every video that I talk about four link and launching a drag car. So look in the description of this video, because it's important, and if I'm going to help you, that's information I'm going to need. I want to find out where that line is. So let's talk about wheelbase. All right, wheelbase, the center of the rear wheel to the center of the front wheel. Okay, let's for this exercise, let's use 108 inches wheelbase. Now, I think everyone understands what wheelbase is. Center of the axle in the rear to the center of the spindle in the front. one tool that is absolutely amazing in doing this calculation is getting the four corner weights. Having scales to scale your car is absolutely critical. We can scale your car for you. If you want my help, go to SampsonPerformance.com. The link is in the description. We can help scale your car for you and do everything we're getting ready to go through so that you can learn how to do it yourself. But in this example, let's say we've scaled this car, and when for this part, what's more important is the front weight and the rear weight. So in this example, let's say we have 1,400 pounds on the rear, we have 2,000 pounds on the front, for a total weight of 3,400 pounds. So let's calculate what our bias is. So on the front, I would take 2,000 divided by 3,400 equals 58.8. So let's call it 59%. Now, on the back, let's take 1,400 divided by 3,400 equals 41. So we got 41% on the back. This is just for this example. Please understand that. This is not a real car. This is something I'm just making up here as we go. Now, we're going to do some more math here. All right? So, what we want to do is I want to determine where on the wheelbase does this center of gravity fall with regard to front and rear. Let's do the math real quick. All right? We know that we have 2,000 on the front, 1,400 on the back. So, I also know my total wheelbase length is 108 inches. If I take 108 times 0.59 equals 63.72. All right, so if I take 108 times 0.59, that gives me 63.72 inches. I can do the same thing back here on the back. So just bear with me. I'm going to tie all this together. So if I do 108 times 0.41, I get 44.28 inches. All right, I can take those two numbers, and now I know, well, let's add those up real quick. Those should equal 108. So if we do 63.72 plus 44.28 equals 108. Now, I can take that number, and I know exactly where my center of gravity should be. I take this front number, and I know 63.72 inches from the center line of the rear end is where my center of gravity falls. I can also do it another way. I can say 44.2 inches from the front center line back is where my center of gravity falls. So I could come over here and I could do it like this. inches is where that center of gravity is. It's backwards. If you're not careful, you'll do the math wrong. The 63.72 that you calculate on the front bias is 63.72 from the rear end. Or the rear number, you apply it to how far you come back from the front end. That's how you calculate where the center of gravity is on your car based on your weights. Like I said, for the height of this from the ground up is important. And unless you follow the example that I have in the description where you have to remove your shocks, put in solid bars in place of all your shocks, weigh your car, jack the rear end up 10 inches, weigh it again so you know what the weight of the front end did, then you can put all that in the calculator and it will tell you the exact height, of your center of gravity. For now, we're going to assume the height of the camshaft to the ground. Why is that so important, Kevin? My gosh, why did you just spend all this time talking to me about this dot? Well, the relationship of that dot with your car and the horizontal line, the imaginary line that you run through that, so you go from the front of your center line of your front spindle up to the height of that line, is where this anti-squat line runs. Okay, so it always starts at the center of your slick, where the slick meets the ground in the center of your axle, up to that point. This line is called your anti-squat line. That's important. Now, let's talk about four link bar angles and angles that are above the line and angles that are below the line. Now that we understand what that diagonal line is, anti-squat line, let's talk about what does it mean to us in relation to our bars. Even with a slick tire car, I'm looking to not have squat, if at all possible. Hey, let me break in here real quick. I want to clarify a little bit more about what I just said about trying to not have squat. There will be times where you may have a little less than 100% anti-squat, especially with a slick car. There are a lot of things that play here. There are a lot of factors that play here on each car. Each car is different. Please don't mistake what I'm saying and say, Kevin said you can never launch a car that has less than 100% anti-squat. That's not what I'm saying. Ideally, to plant that tire, I am looking for some separation to get that slick on the ground though. Sucking that slick up in the car is not something I'm always after. Have we had to do it? Yes. Will it work or can you make it work? Yes. I'm just saying, ideally, I'm looking for something a little closer to 100% or a little bit more than 100% anti-squat. But every car is different. I wanted to jump in here real quick and say that you absolutely can launch a car and make it work with less than 100% anti-squat. It can be done. So, wanted to clarify that and just let you know what I was trying to say there. Even with a slick tire car, I'm looking to not have squat, if at all possible. Why do I say if at all possible? Sometimes we get cars in the shop where I don't know what the person was thinking who welded the brackets on, and where they placed the brackets on the frame and how they placed the brackets on the rear end. Some of the stuff we see is insane, but it is what it is. And most car owners don't want to pay us to cut all that off and completely redo it. It's expensive to do all that. So sometimes we have to make a car that has squat, hook and go. And there are ways to overcome that. Doesn't make it right, but I can take a double adjustable shock, I can crank up the compression on it, I can mess with the spring rate, and I can make that car better with squat, but it's not ideal. Let's talk about that. So let's say we have a lower bar that mounts to the rear end here and kind of goes this way. And then I have an upper bar that mounts to the rear end here and kind of goes this way. So the key is you take and you keep drawing an imaginary line out. And then I keep drawing an imaginary line out this way. And as you can see, I'm just below the anti-squat line. The intersect point of your upper bar and your lower bar, and what I mean is, if you got to keep drawing an imaginary line out, because your lower bar may not be this long. Your upper bar may be longer than what I got here, but it's the imaginary line if those bars kept going. This one almost daggum near landed on the anti-squat line. We'll talk about that more in a minute. But we're below the line, so we have less than 100% anti-squat. So what that means is, because I'm below the line on my four-link bar instant center, this is instant center where I drew that. So your instant center is below the anti-squat line. What's going to happen when you hit that rear end and that rear end twist and the pinion tries to climb that ring gear, when it creates that hit, you're going to have an undesirable effect when you're less than 100% anti-squat. What happens is the wheel, the rear end, and the tire goes this way, and the frame or chassis of the car goes this way. You are literally trying to suck the slick up into the fender well. Well, the road is the other way. The track surface is down here, but you're trying to pull the tire off the track. All right? So unless you're on a track that has a tremendous amount of glue, and unless you have some pretty strong shock compression settings, you're not going to hook ideally. You may hook, but you're not going to have the best 60-foot time you can get out of that setup. Now, we, like I said, we have helped cars have a better 60-foot that have this condition because we may not be able to move bars around. We may not be able to get above the anti-squat line, and that's really unfortunate. This is called less than 100% anti-squat, and you are spending energy trying to suck the tire up into the fender, and you're actually not pushing the car forward as fast as you could be. You're wasting motion. We'll talk about that more in a minute. But now let me erase the board and let's draw an example that falls above the anti-squat line. All right, so I've done some erasing. Let's do some bar angles where the intersect point falls above the line. So let's say we have a lower bar that does this, and we have an upper bar that does this. So if I carry this out, and I carry this out, we cross right here. That right there is our instant center, okay? Now that instant center intersects above the anti-squat line. When the instant center falls above the anti-squat line, now we're starting to plant that rear tire to the track. When the instant center falls above the anti-squat line, now we're starting to plant that rear tire to the track. And this is where slicks and radials begin to part ways. You can have so much extension on a slick that you ball that slick up, wad it up, and it's just gonna chatter and shake and just get all out of whack. But here's what's going on in this situation. So I got my bottom bar, I got my top bar, and they intersect above the line. Now, in this example, we're driving the rear end or the slick, we're driving that down, and the frame, the chassis, is going up. That's rear end separation. We're above the anti-squat line. It's greater than 100% anti-squat. And when we do this, we're planting the tire, separating the chassis up. You'll actually see, if you guys, you've got to do video. You've got to put a video on the side of your car and watch that thing hit. Watch the video of your car leaving.
Perfect.
Between the stuff we're talking about here and a video of your car, if we had some of this data and a video, we could be dangerous. We can make a lot of improvement But that video just doesn't lie. I can slow that video down to super slow motion mode and watch what's happening. So we're planting the tire here. Now, on a slick, we got to be careful. And this is why when I talk with you guys, it's so critical that we understand the installed height of your shock. In one of my previous videos, I talk about a specific strange engineering shock. I just grabbed a shock and use it as an example, a double adjustable shock. And let me just say, double adjustables is absolutely necessary. It's just in today's world, with the kind of power we can make with bolt-ons, turbos, and pro chargers, blowers, and nitrous, the power levels these days is insane. You really, really need double adjustable shocks. We need to independently control compression and independently control extension. That's just a given. Now, depending on how your shock is installed at the installed height, let's say you have a shock with 6 inches of travel, and you've got it installed height, race ready with driver in the car, and you split the difference. So you got 3 inches of extension and 3 inches of compression. When I have a chassis that I can put some separation in and I can get the mount point above the anti-squat line, I'm usually going to err on mounting that shock with more extension travel and less compression travel. I would rather have more ability to control the extension and not top that shock out than compression. Now, you can't run a shock without any compression travel, because that shock has to control the car all the way down the track. And not all tracks are perfectly smooth. Some have bumps, dips, some have ruts. I mean, you need compression and rebound. So please don't take me to the extreme here. But if I had a car that was separating hard, quick, and violently, and I had 6 inches of shock travel, I'm probably going to err on the side of 2 inches of compression and 4 inches of extension. Radio cars, they have shocks that travel. They need a lot more shock travel than a slick car. You're not going to go wrong by having more shock travel. You can have a longer travel shock in a slick car, but in a radio car these days, you really need to have a shock that can do a fair amount of extension travel, and you're going to need a spring that can help support that. We're going to talk about springs in a separate video. All right, so we've got the rear end going down. We've got the body coming up. Now, how does this happen? It's physics. It's trigonometry. We have a bunch of angles and stuff here. If you kind of look at this right here, you have a bottom of a triangle. You have the 90 degree right side of a triangle. And then you have this triangle length. We're working with some basic trigonometry here. So, if you think about, if you hooked a cable to the center of gravity of your car, and you pick that car up so the tires are off the ground, it should balance itself perfectly level if you have the center of gravity right. So if you think about that, and you apply force, and the force comes underneath this line, what's going to happen is the body of the car is going to go down and your front wheels are going to go up, because your force is pushing under the center of gravity. Wheelie. Your car is going to look like it's doing a wheelie. So that's really not what you want. Hey, you know, wheelies are cool and they're fun to look at, but wheelies don't win races. We've been doing chassis work now a long time, and I've never been able to steer a car with the front wheels if the front wheels are off the ground. Now, we can make a car go straight without the front wheels on the ground with a lot of different adjustments, but generally you want to pick the front wheels up a little bit, carry them out, and sit them back down. And when I say a little bit, ideally I'm talking inches, not feet, and then set them down. So by pushing force underneath the center of gravity, underneath this line, you're going to send the chassis to the ground and you're going to lift the front wheels in the air. If you were to push while your car is hanging from the center of gravity and the force pushed above this line, the chassis is going to go up in the air and the front wheels are going to come down. So think about, as that rear end twists, what it's doing above and below that anti-squat line. If your bars intersect above the anti-squat line, it's actually going to drive the slicks to the track, the frame up, and it's, when it drives that frame up, it's actually going to be trying to push the front end down, which will counteract a bunch of wheel stands. And ideally, you want to kind of keep the front end down. We're going to talk about front coilovers and stuff in a different video. So don't get hung up on that. Don't get hung up on front end travel and all right now. Just understand what's happening on the rear end of the car and what's going on with these bar angles. That is going to help you a lot if you can capture that and understand what's happening with these bar angles in this example. Okay, let's bring this to a conclusion. This anti-squat line, in a perfect world where traction was not a problem. Wow, can you imagine that for a second? Ideally, I would rather not be wasting energy doing squatting or separating. If your bar is intersected on the anti-squat line, all of your energy would be pushing the car forward. Think about that for a minute. Now, I haven't found a perfect race car yet that can hook and go in a perfect world all the time. But think about that, because it's all about a balance. I talk about this over and over. It's about a balance. You don't want to have to preload a car so crazy that you get out of balance. You don't want to have to stagger wheelie bars so much that it's just out of balance. You don't want to have to move weight around with an anti-roll bar so much that you're out of balance. You're going to start binding things up. You don't want to have to run springs that are so freaking tight that you can't compress the shock and you can barely get it extended. We'll talk more about that later, but spring selection is critical here. On a slick car, it's about balance. On a radio car, it's about balance. Imagine if we didn't waste any energy doing this and all of our energy was meant to push the car forward. Now we're getting some serious 60 foot. However, the world we live in requires traction. And guys, we're putting down some serious power these days. These cars are making serious power and torque. So we've got to somehow plant that tire, but control it enough so that we don't wad it up. And if you're a radial car, the more extension you can get in that rear end, it feels like the more that radial tire can be slammed in that track, the happier it is. Now, there's a balance. There's a balance to everything, but I'm just using that as an example. So hopefully the anti-squat line makes sense now. Hopefully the center of gravity point, you understand why it's so important, and you understand the relationship to where this anti-squat line crosses the front spindle vertical line. Hopefully bar angles now help you understand things. You can use the website in the description below. You can see an example of it right now while I'm talking. I'm going to show you an example of the Instant Center website and what it shows you and what output it gives you. You can see on the screen right now the bar angles. You see the anti-squat line. You see your Instant Center point. You can see if it's above or below the line. You see your wheelbase are included in here. The height of the Instant Center is included in this picture you're looking at right now. So hopefully bar angles make a little more sense, and you can see some of the calculations that go into me helping you get your car launched. Hopefully this video made some sense. I enjoy this, and I hope it helps you. It's starting to come down pretty hard with rain here, so I'm not sure if you're hearing all that. Hopefully you're able to see the board. I'll have to see how this looks in my video editing, but thank you for taking the time to watch the video. Subscribe to the channel, turn on the alert icon, because I'll be doing more of these videos very soon, and I'd love for you to follow along through the series. This is the four link series. We'll talk about ladder bars, we'll talk about coilover spring rates, we'll talk about rear end pinion angle, We'll talk about front end double adjustable shocks and rise and all that. I'm going to go through all these different subjects with dedicated videos. So thank you for taking the time to watch. And please remember, go fast, go straight, and be safe. Thanks, guys.